Hi everyone, I'm Ebenezer with FUTEK, Advanced Sensor Technology. I'm here today talking to my friend Martin. He's an engineer designer. He is responsible for research and development for micro miniature load cells here at FUTEK. And today we'll be talking about LSB205, which is our evolution of our miniature S-beam load cells. And this product has a lot of cool features, right? So I have some questions for you about those cool features.
Well, as you know, temperature can affect the output of our sensors. So having the embedded PT1000 enables us to monitor the temperature at the sensor level. And with that, we can compensate for the change in output as the temperature changes.
Okay, so for example, I'm just thinking here on application like an industrial oven, right? That the temperature oscillates like maybe 100 to 150 Fahrenheit, right? So how this sensor and the embedded temperature sensor could correct or adjust or compensate for this variation?
Sure. Yeah, the temperature is directly correlated to the output. So if we have a higher temperature, we see a change in the output, and same with the lower temperature, and it's very linear. So okay. With that, we can use the PT1000 and follow that temperature variance and compensate accordingly, depending on the application. This can be done through the output of the RTD or through other devices that we sell similar to the USB225.
And also, this product has a embedded TEDS chip, which stands for Transducer Electronic Data Sheet, right? So why a TEDS chip? It's important or a feature that a engineer should be looking after.
With the TEDS, the TEDS has all the calibration data stored on it. So when we connect a sensor with TEDS to a device similar to the USB225 or the IHH500, that calibration data will be uploaded directly to that device. And from there, you can go straight into your force measurement without having to manually calibrate or enter the calibration data manually into the device, which can occasionally be a problem if the wrong information is entered. So this takes that out of the equation and goes straight into a streamlined system.
And you keep on mentioning the signal conditioner, right? So for example, for the PT1000 and TEDS chip, right, all those embedded features, functionalities of LSB205 to work properly and adequately, you also need like a compatible signal conditioner, right? That's my understanding.
Yes, you don't necessarily need it, but it's very helpful to have something like this because it takes care of all the guesswork on the initial setup of your application. As you mentioned, the USB225 can take the PT1000 RTD input, it can take the TEDS input, and it can use that information to do the compensation calibration in one device rather than configuring this all on your own, on the user end.
So now I want to talk about, I noticed that this sensor has a connector, right? A 7-pin connector, right? And it's different from our previous version, our LSB200, right? Why you decided to change the design and add a connector to this sensor?
There's a few reasons. I'll touch on the first one. Having the connectorized version makes it much more customizable. For example, we can select our sensor per our specs independently of the cable configuration. Mm-hmm. So in this case, this cable configuration is set up for the USB225. We could also purchase a separate cable that would go to, say, an IHH500, or we can even have our own custom cable for an OEM application, independent of the sensor itself.
Okay.
Another reason to go with the connectorized version is we typically see a lot of damaged cables out in the field. And with a connectorized version, it's easy to replace the cable without having to replace the whole sensor system itself.
Okay. So you have the flexibility to swap sensors. Let's say you keep the instrument, but you want to swap to a larger sensor, to a different capacity sensor. You just disconnect the cable and swap the sensor with a different specification. Number one. Number two, if you just need to replace the cable that might be damaged for any operational issue, you don't need to replace the whole system, right? Just replace the cable, which is more cost effective than replacing the full system.
That's right.
Okay. Interesting. And I have another question. So I think you guys from the engineering department, you invest a lot of time and effort in making sure that our products meet the high standards of quality, right? And one of the most important features of those type of sensors is fatigue rating, right? How many cycles it can withstand without, you know, without failure and maintaining the mechanical, electromechanical performance. What can you tell me about the fatigue rating of this product?
Yeah, we take these sensors through a rigorous fatigue rated testing cycle, mm-hmm. which includes full compression and tension mm-hmm. cycling. And we rate them at 100 million cycles.
Oh, wow, 100 million.
And what that means is you will get the same performance from 1,000 cycles all the way up to 100 million cycles, uh-huh. and there will be no variance in its in the sensor performance.
Most of our, you know, the day-to-day application doesn't require like 100 million cycles. So which type of applications would we require like 100 million fatigue rating testing?
There could be a few different situations where you would want a fatigue rated sensor like this. One of them would be, for example, a application where it's very difficult to access the sensor mm-hmm. for replacement maintenance.
Makes sense.
So with a fatigue rated sensor like this, you can have assurance that it will perform the same, as I mentioned, mm-hmm. between 1,000 cycles all the way up to 100 million cycles. So it's low maintenance, so to speak.
Okay.
Another example would be a mission critical scenario. For example, we have a sensor on Mars, mm-hmm. and as you know, it's not very easy to go to Mars and recalibrate or
replace the sensor.
So again, having a sensor that's been fatigue rated for such a high amount of cycles gives the assurance that you know you'll get the same performance.
Yeah. Still on that note of extensive testing, I want to touch a little bit on shock and vibration resistant test. How this test is performing here at FUTEK and why is it important to our product?
Sure. We actually do our own shock drop testing. The machine is actually right behind you. Mm-hmm. And what we do is we drop the sensor in all three axes three times. And each one of those drops is equivalent to about 500 Gs with a pulse width of about 5 to 7 milliseconds.
Wow. 500 Gs.
500 Gs.
All right. And what do guys try to identify after the test? What are you looking for?
Typically, we're looking for any disconnect internally, whether it could be a solder joint or a conductor. But we're looking for the overall health of the sensor between drops.
I always try to correlate what you guys do in the engineering lab with the real life application. So which type of application would require such an extensive shock and vibration test?
There could be different applications where that would be important. For example, if this is on a device that is, say, aircraft, where there's a lot of vibrations and frequencies that go throughout the fuselage of the aircraft, it's important to know that this is not going to be susceptible to those frequencies or shocks that are unpredictable.
Okay. All right. No, that was great. I think we had a great chat, a great conversation about this product. Now, I would like to thank you for your time and thanks for watching. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to FUTEK channel. Thank you.